And I've kind of, over the years, a lot of this is coming from kind of a perspective of yoga practice. And I just recently completed a 200-hour teaching training program. So throughout the certification of my yoga teaching training, that even before that, I kind of started to realize about body movement, so much like language, since there's a lot of linguists in here. In fact, everyone's a linguist except Pam, but Pam might have some background in linguistics. But body movement, just like language, is very socially constructed, right? So we have appropriate ways that we're supposed to stand, appropriate ways that we're supposed to walk in society, appropriate attire, shoes, appropriate ways to sit, like in a Western chair, right? You can sit properly, and you can cross your legs, and you can sit up straight, but you can't, just stand up in class, or you think you can, and you can't, squat down. So it's also kind of rethinking at least what we can do in situations that are different levels of embarrassment, of not conforming to, say, social norms that are actually, in many cases, harmful to the body. At least in the house, in your own home, the privacy of your own home, the privacy of your office, you have a lot more flexibility in the sense of flexibility, the metaphorical meaning that flexibility. Okay, so first of all, I want to just focus a little bit on the whole idea of presence awareness and what's the new fashionable term mindfulness, which I think a lot of people are getting tired of hearing. But the whole point is just as much as we can, being in the moment, being with ourselves, and being in the present moment, not so much, again, focusing on some future goal or some event in the past that we really can't control, right? And of course, it's not to say that we shouldn't plan and think about the future, but we should be aware when we're doing so that we're doing it in a way that is really kind of a plan for and helping you in the present moment, not something about some unobtainable goal that we might have and thinking about it and obsessing about it to the point where it's just gonna eat you up. So there's that. And a lot of this has to do with so much as academics and in an academic setting, we spend all our time up here, so much time up here, thinking about what we're going to do and new ideas and bouncing back and forth. And what happens is, what's happening to me now, you disconnect from your body, right? You're so up in your head that you're realizing, oh, I'm not breathing. Right, or I'm holding my breath, or I'm breathing really shallowly, like up here. And so a little bit, I'm going to talk a little bit about breath today. And then I'm going to also talk a little bit about expanding your workspace to beyond sitting at your desk on a computer, right? As well as a few other things. So there's the sitting in with yourself, more attention when you notice that you're going through a moment of discomfort, rather than like, oh, I have to finish up Professor Shin's or Professor Familia's paper, and you just start to panic about it, I would encourage you to not just say, cool, I can't stress out about that, I have to do something, but actually not, sometimes you have to be with that. You have to say, I am feeling stressed out about this, where am I feeling the stress, where is it affecting my body, okay, my breath's getting short, I'm not breathing, I'm thinking about all these different things at the same time, so I'm unable to focus, and just stop it. And where am I physically? What's going on in my body? Not just putting it on the shelf and saying, I'll get to this later, I'm not going to deal with this. Because you will, it's been proven, you will deal with it eventually. Those things, if you wait, the longer you wait and the longer you build up, the farther in the shelf it gets, and then you'll just end up having a breakdown. I'm speaking from personal experience, not just from students, and I also don't want to give the impression that you're going to reach a point where you have no stress and you are an enlightened person that manages this perfectly. No, it's a constant struggle, and it's going to, no matter, but this, the idea here is just to give you some additional tools so that we can kind of deal with these things as best we can in the moment, right? So just really quick, I want to share this, and this is she's a really awesome instructor, so this is an available resource here at UNM Center for Life, far north over there in the Montgomery Jefferson UNM Center of Life, and she offers classes on mindful stress reduction. I just want to play a little clip by her really quick, just because she articulates.
So in my world, stress is
so much better than me.
Really just a modern day term for suffering. I've never heard anyone say, gosh, I am so stressed out, and I feel really terrific. No, it doesn't happen that way. There's always a certain degree of suffering associated with the experience of stress. And it's happening on two basic levels. In our bodies, we get stomach aches, we get headaches, our neck and shoulders and back get tight and can cause us pain. We get the sense of constriction in the chest and in the breath. Well, this isn't just happening in the body, it's happening in the mind as well. Our minds start to get tight and constricted, and that tight, small feeling as the mind continues to focus on all the things that are going wrong in our life. And then our world vision starts to get very small and tight as well. And it's like, I know you got problems over there, sister, but I really can't help you because I got problems of my own right here. In my opinion, this is really the number one problem with stress. See, how we get to experience our humanity is through our ability to connect with others, with our friends, with our families, with our coworkers, with our pets, with the world of nature. Our sense of humanity is directly dependent upon our ability to connect with others. As stress constricts our minds, so it constricts and eventually restricts our ability to be present with others in our lives. And this has a snowball effect, not only on our stress, but on our life as well. So mindfulness-based stress reduction is the practice of learning how to more effectively use our minds through evidence-based and non-religious meditation to be able to turn off the stress response in the body, thereby decreasing things like high blood pressure, decreasing muscle tension, which can in turn decrease our experience of daily fatigue as well as our experiences of pain. And it can increase our ability to move ourselves more effectively into states of greater rest and relaxation, which can absolutely be a benefit when it's time to go to sleep at night. And in the mind, it can enable ourselves to focus more clearly on our daily tasks, practicing something that we call mental stabilization, which is really the skill that enables us to really weather the daily storms of our professional and personal lives with a certain degree of resiliency, a certain degree of non-reactivity. So in really simple terms, mindfulness-based stress reduction is the practice of cultivating a state that we call relaxed alertness. It's a sense of physical and mental relaxation paired with a sense of alertness, mental focus, awareness, relaxed alertness. And through practice of this cultivation of this skill, it really starts to be enabled as a way of living our lives. So I've taught thousands of programs and literally tens of thousands of people.
Okay. I think we can stop there on this particular video. Think about that. So one of the points here, especially in terms of relationships, which we'll all have to deal with professionally and personally, but one of the main points about mindfulness is we have to first learn to actually be with ourselves, like, and be aware and be present within ourselves and have kind of a compassion for ourselves, our own bodies, our own minds, and see what's going on there. And if we can't do that, like if we can't minimally be in touch with ourselves, imagine how difficult this becomes when we're talking about relationships with other people, right? With our colleagues, with our friends, with our loved ones, everything. If you're not even aware what's going on in your own body, how can you be aware what's going on in someone else's mind and body? You know what I mean? And so that's one of the main things about mindfulness that I think is important to apply to at least our academic lives. Right? And also, in terms of focus, if we have all these kind of scattered concerns, goals, papers, deadlines that we're just thinking about, right? I think there's a citation that the average human thinks about 67,000 thoughts a day, or something like that. I mean, 67,000 thoughts. and something like 75 to 80% are repeated. So revisited. Like, oh, I gotta do that paper. Oh, I gotta do that same paper, right? And you think going back and forth, these repeated thoughts, and again, productive, you know, that's a big question, is do thinking about certain things over and over and repeatedly revisiting, especially past stuff, does it even lead to something productive? And then the thing, so that you don't have to shoot for the goal of being like the most enlightened Buddhist monk who gets supposedly in their best moments of meditation can get down to where they have one thought every 11 seconds. So even the most advanced practitioners of stuff like meditation are it's a constant struggle. So right, when you do this and when you try to sit down, okay, I should just breathe and be with my breath, which we'll get to in a little bit, you will have these thoughts, and everyone does, and you'll be thinking about the rules and stuff. Don't judge, you know, part of this teaching is not to judge yourself about that. Just yes, it's natural, and whenever possible, you come back to the breath, right? Especially in moments of stress. Okay, so I wanted to talk really briefly about power of breath, and again, the talk is scheduled in at 2:50, because of another talk that's coming right after, but I want to definitely leave time just to show you some actual practical applications that we can do immediately and physically. And one of them is breath, and the other one is going to be posture, so rethinking how we do it. So quickly, the power of breath is tremendous, and I don't know how many of you have experienced this, but the benefits of especially what's called deep belly breathing is it calms, aids in digestion, definitely improves focus and concentration, so that's a direct application to at least our professional lives and personal. A feelings of grounding, stability, safety, support. And this is taught, yogis talk about the three-part belly breathing, often refer to the metaphor of a cup of water. You know, as you fill your lungs with breath, we're taught also that we're not supposed to have pot bellies like I do. I don't mind that, that's all I can. But what we want to do is, we're taught, in society, it's more and more, it used to be very directed at women, you know, with imagery that we'd see that, oh, we all have to aspire to look like whoever. I mean, and now I think it's across the board in terms of the gender construct. But we're taught that, oh, I should, you know, tuck my belly in. And you'll notice that people will, when you talk to them, they're always kind of pulling their shirt out because we don't want to show our bellies, right? But part of the three-part belly breathing is so important because when we're doing that, when we're worried that how others might perceive us, we're holding our breath almost all the way up here, right? And so what we're taught is you find the bottom of your rib cage, which I ask everyone just to kind of figure out where the bottom of your rib cage is. That is the bottom of your lung, the base of your lungs. And that is the part where they say that the oxygen exchange is at its highest level. And we'll hear a little bit about this in the video explained by a doctor. But so the three-part belly breathing, if you think of filling a cup of water, the idea is you first start from the very lowest part. You really, if some people may not even be familiar, but you really almost push your belly out and you send that area as low as you possibly can, at the very base of your belly. The lower the better, even if your lungs aren't down there, if you can kind of use your imagination to feel like your lungs are down there and send your breath as low as you can, and then you fill up your chest, and then you fill up your throat, it's going to be drastically different than the patterns that we engage in day-to-day in society when we're breathing all up here. And what it does is it causes hyperventilation, it causes high blood pressure, it causes scattered thoughts, in fact, because this is associated with a fight and flight response, right? So it actually creates your body, you put yourself almost into a panic attack. So the point here with talking a little bit about breath, I want to show this video because it's someone with a lot more medical background, is you can really calm yourself down and really create, and when you do this, it helps encourage more focus, more concentration, and just better well-being overall. So let's just take a quick look at this video.
Have you ever ever felt stressed or overwhelmed and then gotten completely annoyed when somebody chimed in with, "Hey, just take a deep breath"? Hi, I'm Dr. Neha, author of TalkRx, and today you're going to learn about a very underutilized yet extremely powerful tool called soft belly breathing. So I didn't learn about this in medical school. In medical school, I learned about the science of the body and of the lungs, but I never had it all come together and teach me on a practical level how I use this soft belly breathing tool to decrease my stress levels in my everyday life. Now, let me tell you a little bit about how this works. First of all, the physiology of your body, right? We walk around in our everyday lives and we're saying like, "Hey, could you give me this?" "Yeah, I'll be there at 10. "Oh, sorry about that." And we're talking in short sentences and we're barely taking in a breath. So it might be this much of our lungs that we're using. Now, in reality, what physiology did teach me is that our lungs actually take up as much of the space in our chest as our rib cage does. So just take a moment to kind of just feel that border, that outline of your rib cage, because that's how big your lungs are. So where does the best oxygen exchange occur? Well, it's at the bases of our lungs. So you can see how when you're running around in your busy day, you are not utilizing your lungs in the way that they can best serve you and get oxygen to your brain for creative thinking and to the rest of your body. Now, you might feel that when you go running or do yoga or do something of an athletic sort. But in your everyday life, you're not utilizing your lungs in the way that you could. So the way that I saw this in the hospital was my patients would come in and they were always afraid. Many of them, they thought they might die. They were so worried about some symptom that they had. So in their anxiety, they would do the opposite of what I'm going to teach you today. They would do something I refer to as anxiety breathing or panic breathing. And what that is they would take a deep breath in and contract every part of their rib cage, and then as they exhaled, they would let it all out. So they would be doing this. "Yeah, doc, I am breathing, see?" And they would start getting really lightheaded and even more worried and more panicked. So what I did was I would sit down next to them and I would teach them what I'm about to teach you in 5 simple steps. You're gonna know how, when you start to feel uncomfortable in your body, how to manage yourself, manage your emotions, and you can use this even when, you know, the moment you hear somebody in a room taking credit for what it was you did, or somebody says something and you feel that stress response happening, this is what you do. Instead of doing the panic breathing, which most people do, or stopping breathing, which is another thing they do, you're gonna do this. Step number 1, I need you to just allow yourself to have gravity bring your shoulders down, okay? And step 2, I want you to take your abdomen. I'm going to turn sideways here, okay? And I'm going to have you place your hand on your abdomen. That's step 2. Step.
And here you may even want to, I would suggest doing this, and you may even want to go lower than what she's doing because, again, the imaginative capacity is incredible. And so even if she's putting her hand where the lung base is, you're still going to feel a rise from the very lowest part of your belly, and just by imagining you're shooting your air, the oxygen, that to the deepest part, even if it's beyond where the lungs are, it's going to have a positive effect.
Step 3 is that you're going to relax your belly. Now, ladies, I know that our society doesn't let us get away with that. In fact, we've created things like Spanx to help suck it all in, right? But in this moment, I want you to just allow your belly to be soft. Because when your belly is soft, the rest of your muscles relax. So your hands on your abdomen, your belly's soft, and step 3 is you're now taking a nice deep breath in, and you're going to completely fill your lungs with air. So much so that your hand moves outward. Step 4 is that you're going to exhale, and your belly button is going to move back towards your spine. And step 5 is that we're going to repeat that 3 times together. So here we go. one more time. A nice, soft, deep belly breath in, letting your hand move out, and then exhale, where your hand and your belly button move back towards your spine. And just take a moment to notice how you feel. There might be a shift in your body. You might just notice a sense of calm, or you may not have noticed anything. You might want to try a few more breaths. So soft belly breathing can be used anytime you start to feel tense in your body, you start to feel emotional, or you just want to get re-centered and grounded. It's a really simple tool. And the reason it works so well is, so our best oxygen exchange occurs at the bases of our lungs, right? Well, you have this thin, umbrella-shaped muscle called your diaphragm, and it's located just below your lungs and above your stomach. Now, when you take those deep breaths you just did, what happens is the diaphragm actually flattens. And when it does, it triggers something called your vagus nerve, which is, triggers your relaxation system in your body. So that slows down your heart rate and gives you a sense of feeling calm. So listen, I have a lot of drugs that can do this for you and stimulate that system as well. But you have all the equipment inside you, and it's free. You just got to remember to use it.
So, and again, we're in a classroom. We're just kind of talking about this. So you may not be feeling any of those effects after three little short breaths, and plus a lot of people are even more, you know, in an extreme state of stress. So just keep this in mind. And then there's a few things I wanted to add to that. And in addition, so once you get this, I would definitely suggest that people who are not familiar with this, take this home with them, and those who are familiar with this as a reminder to ourselves, which I need to remind myself every day. I constantly catch myself keeping my breath up here, or holding my breath, especially when I teach. You may notice this as I'm like, right, and realize. But just take this three-part belly breath home with you, and then in addition to that, there's this other thing called slight constriction throat breathing, ujjayi breathing in yogi terminology. And it's the idea of, it especially emphasizes, you know, we can, when we think of slowing down our breath, we really focus on the inhale, so, right? And there is really, really, I just did a really, really short inhale. But then we don't think so much about the exhale. But one of the calming effects, you can get an additional calming effect, not only by doing the three-part belly breathing, but by really slowing down your breathing pattern, right? So on the inhale, you try to take in a 4 to 6 second inhale, right? Using the three-part belly breathing. And then on the exhale, you try to slow it down to at least the same length of time, 4 to 6 seconds on the exhale. And one of the ways to do this is what's called a slight constriction throat breathing, where you're creating an ocean sound. Or it's sounding like Darth Vader, so to speak, right? And what this does, that constriction really will help you slow down secondarily. By constricting your throat, you're creating, where the air passes through, you're creating a reminder that, oh, I'm breathing, and I feel it in my body, right? In addition to the fact that your stomach's going out and then coming back in as you breathe. So it's a way to kind of, again, bring your own body to the present, focus on your belly going in, your belly going out, the feel of the breath on your throat, oh, thank you, as opposed to this paper I've got due, or this person who's irritating me, and all these things that we can't control, right? Okay, so again, keep that in mind. Not only the three-part belly breathing and its calming and therapeutic effects it will have on your body that are immediate, but also the idea of slowing down and using possibly this other additional tool. Again, pretend you're imitating Darth Vader. It doesn't have to be super exaggerated.
It's only when you exhale.
Right.
Yes.
It'll sound like, you know, an ocean. An ocean sound. Okay. So then, this one was something that I meant to put at the beginning. But again, the causes of stress, we don't have to go through them all, but there are all these things that we associate with negativity, right, that I mentioned at the outset. And again, the physical ramifications are shallow breath, tightness of chest. Sometimes it can be heaviness, those who are more prone to depression. Other times it can be lightness, the opposite extremes, scattered thoughts, fragmented, really is impairing. That's what I suffer with most. It also depends kind of on your own body type, your own mind type. Other people are prone to more depressive heaviness. Oh, I can't get anything done because I'm feeling so lousy. And others are hyperactive and can't really keep focused. And I'm definitely that one. Okay, so then the last part of this class, and so we've got 15 minutes. I just want to show you guys some. First of all, sometimes I take off my shoes, and the reason for that, again, we're talking, you should wear shoes in public or what have you. And what happens is then you're bound to the shape of the soles of the shoe product that you're wearing, which, you know, may or may not accurately, you know, or some are better than others, this, that, and the other, but it definitely limits, right? Because now you're based on the shoe type, which is probably made for the average human, which everyone, if you know anatomy, every body type is different. So by taking off your shoes, you're increasing your groundedness with the earth, right? Which has a couple of effects. You feel more grounded, and that's gonna have effects both mentally and physically. And by doing that, you're increasing your capacity to distribute the weight in a more natural way. So the first thing, and I do this a lot, this is probably my favorite work situation at home, and when I teach, I'll sit down sometimes, as you know. But when I teach, when I work at home and I'm reading or I'm working on the computer, I've set up a system like this, like what Pam has here, where I can work at home in a standing position rather than sitting down and doing spinal compression. And so what's good about this, but you can't just stand and doing all this stuff and think you're training your body well just by standing. You have to really realize the importance of, you want to try to, when we're being with our bodies, the more and more we can do this, we'll realize, why am I doing that? I'm just like tightening my arm for no reason, or my jaw, or my tongue is jamming into my upper teeth, right? And as more and more we can kind of just be aware, self-awareness of the body, we're realizing we're engaging in physical activities that are harmful, right? And they're also inefficient in terms of expenditure of energy, right? Why is my arm just flexing and I'm tightening my arm or my jaw? And so when we stand and we're working, even when we're staying at work, we want to make sure that our feet are kind of grounded and we're... the truth is about our bodies, we're not, even if we think we're standing still, we're moving, right? And the movement is fine, embrace that, you know? So we should start kind of seeing yourself as a being that's in a constantly moving world, right? And so that, the world's, what do you call that? What?
Turning.
There you go. We're in a world that's rotating all the time, right? And so as human beings, we're also not going to be stable, fixed, anything. So you sort of embrace the body movement. And while you're working, you can, just be aware that you want to try to always keep kind of a posture where your arms, your shoulders are not tense, or your neck is not tense, and your body is in a very erect position. Almost like a string was coming out of the top of your head and holding you from this, dangling you from the sky, right? Or if you can imagine a line, that line is going straight, and the moment you're doing this, or the moment you're doing that, I mean, this is, it's fine to do this occasionally just to get some movement in your body, but just to always be aware of your posture, right? And then when your feet, I'm tired of doing this, then you can move to another position. And, a Western chair is perfectly fine, as long as we realize, when we're engaging in a seated position, our blood flow and everything is right in spinal compression, first of all, in the lower back, but also our blood flow will tend to just stop around here and be stagnated in that moment. So I have a ton of props, and every individual is going to have a different body than me, all right? And so I'm not saying, when I show you this set of things that I use, It's very personalized. It's the things that work for me. And I'll mention some other things that you might be able to adapt for your own needs, but it's important to think, okay, well, everyone's going to have different props. Not everyone's got these fancy Thai yoga, Thai massage props that I have. But, you know, like even a chair would be a good option for propping up my computer today, possibly, right? And so, in my case, I use another bolster like this, but I couldn't fit it into my bag. But the very first one is called the Thunderbolt.
Can you
hold
the chair so you can see?
Sure. Sorry.
Yeah.
But basically, and it's good to have your, the other thing is obviously jeans isn't the, are not, they're not the ideal working clothes, right? You'll probably want to, you know, be in pajamas or, you know, yogi pants or sweatpants or something like that. It's not restricted. But just sitting like this, what I've done is, yes, I still have spinal compression, right? I still have some of the weight on my butt, but I'm also adding to the base, the bottom of my ankles. In my case, this works. It won't necessarily work for everybody. My shins, my knees, and my butt. So I've taken from this, where it's pretty much all in my butt, all spinal compression, and my feet are barely touching the ground. So from that, I move to this, and it's a whole different new foundation, right? It's increasing a lot more of the body contact. So that's one that you can do. And this will get tiring. And that, again, that's the importance of breathing and being aware of what's going on in your body. This is also not ideal, right? So when we set up our workstation, right, you also don't want to be setting one up where you're looking down. So ideally, in my home props, this would probably come up to about here, right? You want to be aware, like, of your shoulders. So what you end up with in an ideal situation with the right props is a situation where you're working like this, right? Where your shoulders are kind of dropping down to the ground. Your breath isn't restricted. Your neck isn't cranked forward. And you know, the nice thing about the laptops is you can set a pretty healthy situation in terms of your posture with this type of a setup. Then I also will work a lot like this, right? Sit, just, you know, with the same type of situation. I'm on my butt, but I've got a lot more contact here. And now, depending on how tight we are in our inner thighs, and everyone's going to have different degrees of openness and tightness.
Yeah.
That's where it's nice to have these type of things, so that what happens is, if you're like trying to, and you think, oh, you know, I have to be like that yogi person, and you know, the 21-year-old that's doing back bends and this, that, and the other, which I never have any aspirations of doing. If we think we're like that, then we can end up, like, this is the one thing I want to say to you is, don't look at these postures and think they're going to look the same for you. Every individual is different. We have different bone structures, actually, different degrees of external and internal openness. And I happen to be pretty externally rotated, so this is okay for me, and the only reason that they're not touching is because I have a lot of muscle tension, but it's not a bone issue as much. And so if I'm not protecting, especially right now, just today in the last couple of weeks, my right knee has been kind of an aggravation. So it's really helpful to be able to have a prop or two to support those knees in addition. So even though what this does is it increases the amount of pressure that's on the butt, it's still touching here, and so we have a little additional support. We have support here, and it's a different position too.
Yeah.
Your legs are being different way. So there's that. And then, of course, the other thing I want to add to that is what a lot of people do, and in this isn't something that you want to, you want to start these different floor postures, if you do end up adopting them, slowly. Because unless you do this regularly, which I do, this is the only way I work. I rarely sit at a desk, except when I'm in my office, because I don't want people looking at me too funny. I'm a little, I'll probably not. But yeah, this is something I would add to your arsenal of postures. Very starts with, you know, 5-10 minutes a day, and then just slowly add to this, because it does require a new set of muscles that you build up. So there's this, and then the other thing is, here's where I went with this, going with this, because my mind is all scattered. But you'll have the tendency to pelvis like this, right? Your pelvis will, for some people, is gonna rock back. And so one of the things you can do with a towel, can be a blanket, is put it right under your, so your sits bones are being supported in a way that's gonna, rather than the pelvis rotating back and you dropping into your lower back, which can really be dangerous if you're not protecting it. Your lower back, your pelvis should be upright, right? Not dropping into it like this, and not over hyperextending it either. So one of the ways you can do that is with a towel or a blanket, just putting it right under your sits bones and get that pelvis to kind of rotate forward. See? So there's that. And then, of course, the use of the props. And these are the, among the last ones I'll show. Let's see what I need. So, like another one that you can do is the what's called the dragonfly. And what I like about this one is because I don't know if any of you, but I have super, my biggest point of stress and suffering is in the hamstrings. They're like, sometimes they feel like, I joke that they're calcified. I feel like where I should have muscle, it's becoming bone. I mean, it's that my ligaments, and especially right behind the knee, are so tight. And so one of the things I do sometimes while I work is I'll set up a prop, a situation where, first of all, my hips are off the ground, so they're above my knee, my legs, which is a way to protect your lower back. And then I'll have another prop like this, which I can support the knee. Can everyone see this? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so by working, and I'm still, you're always kind of paying attention to kind of maintaining your, oh yeah, sure, thank you. Kind of an upright posture with your back. Again, the idea of the string coming from the ceiling. But I'm actually working while stretching my hamstrings. See? There's that, and then you can switch sides, right? And this is what I end up, because my hamstrings are so tight, and I doubt anyone in the class will have them as tight as mine. It's kind of a constant point of suffering. But in fact, I usually use a larger bolster for my knees. But the other thing you can do, very similar to this, is the one that's kind of off to the side, like a half dragonfly. And again, the importance is you have to really be paying attention to your body and think about, how is your body feeling? Like if you start to feel that something's wrong, something probably is wrong, and maybe that posture is not right for you, or maybe you need to do something to adjust it. Right? So it does require that, okay, since I saw this guy doing it, it's got to work in my body? No. The walk point is really be aware of what's going on in your own body constantly and adjust these postures and explore, right? If you get more and more. But the point is, by moving away from, say, the Western chair and desk, idea that that's how we're supposed to work, you can end up with a whole bunch of more postures and ways to sit, ways to treat your body nicer than if we think, oh, I have to get this paper done for at this particular time, so I'm going to sit here in the desk until it's done. I mean, yeah, we run into deadlines like that, and there's times where we have to really put in a ton of work, but if you can actually realize that, you know, okay, yeah, I do have to work, but I'm going to pay attention to my body while I do. And there's, here's another one. You can just, like, also just the squat where you're squatting like this. Here you got to pay attention to the knees. Because different people will have different results. And knees can be pretty sensitive, so definitely pay attention to that. There's a few other things I need to say. The other thing is, yeah, take breaks, right? We can't work effectively, even a half an hour is a lot. I mean, you really think about it, it takes a long time to write a final paper, but even 30 minutes straight work, your concentration's gonna start to decrease. Your body you need to get up, you need to move around, stand up, go get drinks, all that stuff. You don't wanna just think that you have to sit at a desk and da-da-da-da-da and work straight until the paper's done, no? Because what ends up happening is you might even end up working longer because the time that you are dedicating to the work is not as efficient, and it can be in some cases even harmful. So And then some of you that went to the yin yoga practice, there's also things that you can do in between, which are not what I would call work positions. So there's positions that I would classify as ones that are yoga-based, yin yoga postures that allow also you to do focused work, like the ones that I just showed you. But then in between the work, right, there's the ones like the so-called child's pose, where you know you just can lay on a bolster for a while, and what that does is the back muscles that have been engaged while you're working are really tight, and so by doing a posture like that, it's a nice break, right? It's a nice way to give your body a rest, not be shallow breathing like I am right now, right? But a moment where you can say, okay, cool, let's come back to me, how am I doing? And a moment just where, all right, I'm gonna stop thinking about this paper or this project or this email and just take a short break, right? And just, a child's pose is one, right? I'm trying to think, the other ones are, like when you get up, you may wanna take a moment where you do a forward bend and just, and again, the forward bend, when I say this, do not think that you need to, and I'm super tight, so do not think that you need to keep your knees straight or your legs straight. Here, the deeper the bend, the better when you take this type of a break, right? You bend them, and you can see I bend mine a lot. Because my hamstrings are so tight, you need to dangle the arms for a while. Again, here you'll have more restricted breath because you're folding in, so you want to be aware of that. And make sure you continue your a healthy breathing pattern. You're not creating a hyperventilation situation. Right. So there's a few things that I wanted to share with y'all. Again, the idea of the floor space and using the floor as a way to sort of protect your body. And again, moving beyond that limited set of work situations. By moving it to the floor, you increase your repertoire by a ton. It's a way to have your body position again with a whole bunch of more diverse configurations that will be more suitable for your own needs, to be honest. And this is only a slight set. There's, I mean, a ton of other options you can do. I don't like it, but one that is like the half dragonfly I showed you with one leg out and the other one propped or back, you can do it with both legs out. That's really rough on me because then rather than two hardcore rubber bands pulling at my lower back, which the hamstrings will come up all the way and they connect up here. So I've got two things pulling at my lower back. And so when I do that one, I have to bolster my legs up really high. And yeah, so that's what I've got for today. I hope it was useful. I wanted at least a little bit of time in case there's any questions or comments or suggestions.
Yeah, well, I particularly had a surgery because of scoliosis. But before that, the intervention was very successful because I practiced yoga and ballet before. And normally I discovered that everything that you have done is very effective. The only thing which I have to pay attention to, but I imagine that any other person can be complained about it, is that my back get weak very easily. So normally what that I do, everything you can say is very effective, but I used to look for the support of the aha of
wall.
The wall.
I'm so glad you mentioned that.
So normally I can advise that if any of you practice what Ruth has explained, but you feel like some type of weakness about your back muscle, the only you can try with taking a support from the wall, and it works perfectly.
Exactly. No, and so the wall is one of the most underutilized
yeah.
tools that we have. In fact,
yeah.
now that you mentioned it, since there's a little time, the other thing you can do, in addition to what Katha is saying, where you can do the same postures but against the wall, then you
yeah.
can use as a rest posture. You just,
yeah.
What you do is you turn around and you snug your butt up against the wall as much as you can get it, and then up the wall you go.
Yes, that's perfect.
And you
want
to, especially with me, I have to keep these pretty well bent. But you just take a moment where all these fluids that were kind of stagnated in the legs are going to come down. You get more of a circulation of blood flow. You can also kind of go out like in splits. And that's a really good way to loosen up the legs and take a break, right? It's not a work posture.
Yeah,
it's a rest posture.
But the linearity of your body is rearranged.
That's right, yep.
Because what you said about the center of the body is essential. If
that's
you don't
right.
discover your own center, anything else is useless.
Yes, that's so true. And the wall is fantastic for back support.
Yeah.
For people who have back pain or suffering back pain, this is a great way to keep kind of those same postures, but also get some back support.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for bringing that up.
Oh, no, you're welcome.
Gerardo,
do you always recommend a hard surface, como el piso, or like if you're on your bed?
It depends, like on the firmness of the mattress. I mean, I think you can. The problem with the bed is sometimes it's not as grounding as the floor. So, not as grounding, I mean, you'll end up, you have a little more risk, I think, this is my opinion, a little higher risk of adopting postures that are a little less healthy, for lack of a better word. Like you might catch yourself, you know, depending on how you're sitting, maybe you're going to sink in, so your lumbar is going to be kind of off to the side. I would say firm. There's nothing wrong. Like I use from the same company. They make these Thai massage mats or a yoga mat or a rug or a carpeted floor. Like this is fine. I mean, there you want to make sure that you know you're on a clean surface and not, and also not let that be a hindrance. Like I'm a OCD, you might imagine, and so one of my big the big obstacle that I let myself believe and I've internalized, and then I realized, wait, just sweep the floor and clean it up, and then you've got your workspace. But it's too dusty. So rather than clean it up, I'll go to the bed, and then I'll realize, no, you know, not as good as is the floor.
Okay.
Right. But there, yeah, you want to make sure the floor is clean and just that.
And also, I have exactly the same problem with como
tight hamstrings.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
right here.
Yeah.
Area.
Yeah.
Do you like?
Yeah.
Want that.
Okay.
It's always hard whether I flex or not.
Right.
Se me duerme, like, in any position, se me duerme muy rápido en las piernas. Do you recommend anything for like my leg go numb right away?
In generally when that happens, what posture
like
are you in?
This.
Oh, when you sit like that. So when you sit like this, you're saying your foot goes to sleep and you sit like this. Yeah, then I wouldn't do that. I would try this too. Right? You can also like set it off to the side. See if that helps.
Okay.
Right? Also, then you can put them both forward as long as you're protecting your back. And on this one, for me, for example, the wall would be ideal. I'd cut this up. Yeah, be aware of it. Move around. Get up more. You may have to, you know, work a little bit more standing up or move around. Take more breaks. Right? I don't have a lot of medical knowledge, so I couldn't say too much about that. But if you're tight, yeah, you may want to. Are you running a lot?
No.
You run a lot?
Sports.
Yeah. I mean, that could be it, just getting tight and not paying enough attention, stretching. Right, a little more.
Where can we buy those pillows?
And these are just, yeah, I would say try to, first, I would experiment first with props in the house. Don't buy anything until you kind of see, like start using pillows. Oh, this one's too soft. So maybe you'll think about, okay, maybe I do need this. Or maybe you've already got something in the house that will work. So I would try to find those first and experiment with what you've got. And then once you've figured out that there may be a need for a purchase, then I would say you could look into that. But a yoga, I would say rather than these, because these are probably a little on the pricey side. And yoga bolsters are probably just as good. I would just do a search, Amazon or a local outlet store that sells yoga products, anything like that, if you need a bolster. I think a bolster is a great tool. And so likely, you will want to buy some sort of a bolster. And so I would say a yoga bolster would be great. And probably, unfortunately, online is where you're going to get probably the best deals.
And what do you think about the forget what they're called, the ball.
The
thing.
Ball. I think it's good. I think anything. They also, I also have a chair where if you sit here and then your knees are supported. I use that sometimes, but now my preference is the floor. But I do like that. In the ball, my wife uses that.
And she sits and works.
And she sits and works for a while. I would say mixing it up and the more movement and rotating from different position to position is the key. Because if you catch yourself in anything, like if you're standing up for an extended period of time, you're limiting your body to a particular configuration. So movement is always great, I would think. So the more you can mix things up. And I think the ball's great. I've tried that and like it. It's not part of my normal routine, but when I've used it, I've been pleased with it. Yeah, I think it's good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you can kind of like slide it around, and then if you want, go into a back bend.
Right.
Cool. Any other comments or suggestions? Anything that you guys do that, like, how do you all work? Like, is there anything that that sounds that maybe a little embarrassing, but now that I've revealed all my embarrassing things?
The smartphones have like a bunch of different mindfulness apps that I use. When at my old office, it was a really progressive office, and we had Mindfulness Mondays, and we would, no matter what, how busy the day was, we set aside an hour to be mindful and like do different mindful activities.
That's cool.
Yeah, and so I just kind of utilize that. There's so many different free ones that you pay for, monthly subscriptions, but just taking, you know, like we all have so much to do, and yeah, it's stressful to get all our papers in on time, but like Rich said, it's like you can focus for 30 minutes, and then at some point, it's actually more helpful to take 30, 15 minutes to really just breathe and center yourself and then get back to your work.
Yeah, oh, that's so true. Well, we should stop for today. Yeah, thank you all.
Thank you.